So, Wario of Light's EX job was announced on Wednesday. Originally, when he was released, he was the best tank in War of the Vision. He was the only character that could generate hate using a TP ability, which meant he could do that without hitting the enemy team, which was really unique at the time. Now we have some other tanks that can do that, and guess what? They're all the best tanks in the game. So, it's still a very, very good aspect. Before we dive into his review, I do want to say, I have an Amazon affiliate link. If you want to use that to support the channel, please go ahead. Otherwise, there are a ton of other content creators that have those. Just use one of our links. It's a great community. As long as you support somebody from there, I'm happy with that. So, moving on. He is an extremely versatile tank, even at 99, but even better so when he gets his EX job. He is great against physical attacks, he has a ton of defense, can increase that further, and then has good resistances all around for physical attacks. Against magic, he's also very good. Not as good, but solid. He has a decent spirit, and then he has the Spellblade subjob, so he can actually put everybody's magic resistance through the roof, which is a good thing. And then, he is self-sufficient. He has the ability to heal himself and generate barriers, and his AI is actually intelligent enough to use the self-healing abilities at the right time. So, it's really hard to take out Wario of Light, and he can also support pretty well. He's got the Spellblade sub, as I was saying, which allows him to increase magic resistance from other guys. He can give barriers to himself, but also to his teammates. And then if you put the Wario of Light sub job on, he has some decent debuffs where he can decrease attack and magic, and then CC people with stop. So there are a bunch of options. His other sub job is Dragoon. Honestly, he's not a character that I would use for damage that much, but I have seen Dragoon Wario of Light do a good job in the past. So, in case you weren't around during his initial release, here is his main job, his unique job. What's really noteworthy there is, first of all, Brave Presence. That ability increases his defense and spirit, and then increases his hate. So, that's his bread and butter, it's the main reason why he's a good tank. Then he has Breath of Life, which is an ability that heals him for a percentage of his maximum HP. That is one of the heals in the game that does not depend on magic, it just portion of his max HP, so it's a really reliable heal. And then, as I was saying, he has an ability to put a barrier on an ally, which reduces physical damage. Now that's going to change with his EX job, but we'll get to that in a minute. And then in his Wario of Light sub job, he has Deterrent Sword, which decreases attack and magic, but only in melee range, or Stub Strike, which is a little bit of a longer range attack that has a chance to stub. 25% is not a very high chance, but if it does land, that's game-breaking for the enemy team. They just lose a character, basically, for the whole fight. So, let's look at the stats that 120 Wario of Light brings, and we'll compare him with two other tanks that, even right now in JP, are still very good and very much used. So, in terms of HP, Wario of Light is very high. He has just about the same amount of HP as King Mont, who, as we all know, is the top tier tank right now, so that's a really good thing. And then he has the same mobility as King Mont Baze, but King Mont is a ninja. He can get to 4-2, while Wario of Light can only get to 3-move jump 2. So he's less mobile overall than what Wario of Light has, unless you're equipping him with the Dragoon sub job and using Dragoon Standard manually, which not a lot of people are gonna do, I think. Then he has more defense and spirit than King Mont, which is really cool. He's not as good as a spirit tank as what Charlotte will be, but Charlotte is really specialized against magical attacks and less so against physical attacks. King Mont more specialized towards physical attacks, as you probably know. Wario of Light is the guy that can do a little bit of both pretty well, so he's a middleman here. But a base 17 defense and 6 spirit is really beastly, it's a super good pro for him. Then he's got a solid attack at 437, which means he can do okay damage, but he doesn't have the super large AoE attacks or the super high mod damage attacks that King Mont has, so don't expect him to go over the roof and kill people, that's not his role. His main drawback compared to those two other tanks is his slow speed. He's got only 56 agility, which means he will not go before everything else like King Mont does, right? He's not a fast tank, he's a sturdy one. So overall, that's what his stats look like. In terms of resistances, Wario of Light is a little bit weak to dark, but he has ways to make up for that. And then he's weak to piercing, which fortunately right now is not a very used damage type. Then, if you have Warrior of Light at level 99, and you decide to get him to EX jobs, I think 115 is a decent stop for him. In terms of stats, you gain most of your upgrade just by going there. Your HP goes to 4500, you do get 4 points of agility, going from 52 to 56, your attack goes up to 400, and then you gain some extra defense, going from 13 to 17. All that just from getting to 115. Now, of course, you do gain some extra stats at 120, that's about 700 more HP, 30 more attack, so that's nice and all, but you don't get more defense or agility, which I feel are the biggest things. So I think unless you want the EX ability that he gets at 120, you can potentially stop at 115 and get a really, really good performance out of him. So what are these EX abilities? Well, the first thing that he has an upgrade on is Breath of Life. This ability originally had a cast time and could be used only once in the fight. Now it's way better. He can use it twice, it's instant, and it's gonna heal 60% of his max HP. So that means you can walk into a fight with 8000 HP, and then a couple times throughout, heal for like 5000, just instantly. That is crazy on a tank. Now, his AI does have to use it if you're playing on auto, but on manual game modes, that means you have a very reliable way of having your tank just survive the entire fight without needing to bring a healer in your team, which is really good. Then his other ability upgrade is the Invincible Shield. You can still target an ally, it's the same kind of ability. The main difference is now it's going to reduce physical and magical defense, so it's just more of a versatile shield. Now, a 35% shield is not the strongest that we see in the game, right? We have a lot of shields that shield for 50%, but it's still a 3x shield that he can cast on whoever he wants, which I think is really good, especially if you're using him manually in some sort of tower content or just manual PvP. You can target the squishy member that you need to survive, and they're going to be much more durable, so it's pretty good. And then his new ability is actually pretty good. It's a long-range AoE attack, which is fun, that he can use twice, and that's going to give him regen for 3 turns. Now, regen is not the best thing in War of the Visions, because it's a very slow healing, and damage comes in quick and hard when you use top-tier damage dealers. But for a guy that's going to walk into a fight with 8,000-9,000 HP, it's 800, 900 more HP that he's gonna get every time he acts. So, it's not bad, especially since it's one of his longest range abilities, so my expectation is he's going to go close in on the enemy team, use this, get regen, and then on his following turns possibly use different attacks. So he's going to use that when he gets in contact with the enemy team. He's going to get the full value out of that regen. Often, regen abilities are buffs that are used in the first turns of combat, and then you kind of waste the regen turns just closing in on the enemy team, but in his case, since it's tied to an attack, it's going to go up at the right timing, so an interesting one. Now, in terms of team affinity, well, he's a tank, so a little bit like King Mon, you don't need to have a team that has great affinity with him to get a good value. His main job is to stay in front of your team, maintain hate, and just survive for as long as possible for your other guys to do their job. With that said though, Warrior of Light is a really good character to use in a light squad, and the main reason for that is he has light slash attacks which chain with other people, and his limit burst is an AoE 3-hit light slash chain. So if he drops that on the enemy team and then you follow that with a Sakura limit burst or just any other attack from a light character or even light slashing character, you're going to deal crazy damage. Because of that, I think he works well in a light squad of our EX units. Yuna is one of them, King Rob is one of them, but even with Sakura or Elcirel, they are natural good partners, so that's pretty fun. Otherwise, he's a tank. Just pair him with top tier attackers and he's going to do a good job. Frederica's great because she's going to stay far enough that she doesn't stay in the same AoEs as Warrior of Light. Garvel, top tier damage, Luel, Gilgamesh. All these characters are going to be good with him because they need to survive to do their job, and he's there to do that, so don't worry about affinity too much, I think. He's just really good as is. So let's look at a couple builds for Warrior of Light, and first is our out-of-the-mill basic physical tank character. First, with the release of Warrior of Light, there will be a new sword that's craftable for a limited time, and that gives light attack up. You should craft a couple of these, even if you don't go for Warrior of Light, just because Light Attack Up is so good. We have many sword-using Light characters, Ramzas, Cecil, Engelbert, and I'm sure there will be a ton more that are released as the game progresses. So definitely get that, it's the sword I'm using on Warrior of Light for this build. So what we want is somebody who survives physical punishment very well while having some decent utility in front of the battlefield. So the Warrior of Light sub-job is perfect for that. We've put Golem on him for as much defense as possible, and then the Death Machine card and the Brigandine armor for as much AoE resistance as possible, just in case his other teammates are close by and he gets hit by AoE attacks instead. So that guy walks into the fight with over 8,000 HP, 64 defense, and 11 spirit, but his buff that generates hate also gives him 12 defense and spirit. So in reality, when he clashes with the enemy team, he's going to have 76 defense and 23 spirit. Okay versus magic, not great, but against physical attacks, 76 is a crazy amount of defense. And then he still has 30% slash resistance for the most common damage type in the game, decent pierce resistance as well, so all his physical resistances are positive. So overall, that is a build to make him survive as long as possible versus physical attackers, and he should do that pretty well. And then he still has 822 attack, without an attack up card on another teammate. And the stats that we're seeing here on screen are without taking into account the vision cards from other teammates. So we could push his stats much higher, for example, using the Rob card that gives extra attack for all the light units in your team. Now, this second build is probably what I would run if I was going for Warrior of Light, and that's the hybrid tank that can take both magical and physical punishment pretty well. We're swapping his sub job for a Spellblade, because that gives him access to magic resistance, which is key and is also a supportive ability. In this build, we don't have a good offensive weapon for him. He's really more there to survive for a long while. We're putting Tidus's necklace for a lot of spirit, Brigandine for some armor, and taking Silma's TMR for some slash resistance, because why not? And then our Esper this time is Titan, which is an Esper that gives extra spirit. 15 more spirit will come in handy for this character. And then since we're going to be fighting mages as well as physical attackers, Fenrir is going to help Warrior of Light with two things. It's going to give magic resistance, but it's also going to increase his agility a little bit, because we know he's not a fast character. So he walks into the fight with over 8,000 HP still, but this time a lot less attack at 757 and no light attack up from his weapon, so he won't do as much damage. In exchange though, he has a ton more spirit and magic resistance. So he would have 49 base defense, goes up to 61 with his buff, which is still really good, so he can take physical attacks pretty well. Then 38 to 50 with his buff spirit, so he's really hard to kill. Even with Black Witch Helena's debuff, he would still have a 20 spirit remaining, which is not bad. But mainly, his magic resistance begins at 47, and if he uses the magic resistance buff from the Spellblade job, he has 85% magic resistance on top of everything else. So that seems to me like an invincible build. And the thing about Warrior of Light is if he falls low, but the attack does not kill him, he's just going to use his Breath of Life and heal for 60% of his max HP. So you need to take him out in a very short amount of time so that he doesn't get a turn while he's low HP. Otherwise, you have to start it over again. So yeah, I would run him like this, I think. It seems like a very solid build for me. Now, here's a final build that I put in there because it seems like a really, really fun thing, but I could not build that because it's full of time-limited stuff. Still though, let's look at it. I called it Banish the Darkness because it's a versus dark character build. What you need for that is the Light Bangle that gives dark resistance, and the like Sundrite Ring for some all element resistance. I put Rob's TMR in there because why not? Keenblade is not a bad ability, but you could use any TMR you like, it's not important for the build. Then you need the Demon Wall Esper because that gives dark resistance. And then the, I'm not even sure what this card's name is, Signs of Shadow, I think, but the limited Final Fantasy XIV card that gives some light attack up and dark resistance to your characters. And the whole idea here is Warrior of Light walks into the fight with 72% dark resistance and 40% light resistance. I know Black Witch Helena and some of the other dark characters can break dark resistance, but still, 72% is very reliable, so he can take out those dark teams pretty well. especially since he still has up to 53 defense, 25 spirit, and 55 magic resistance. So we're not sacrificing all that much of the other stats. He is still very tanky against non-dark units with this build. So yeah, just a for fun build that you guys could try if you have all that stuff. So what are some ways to fight Warrior of Light and win against teams that have him? Well, I would say the best thing to do, since he's such a hard to kill character, is to ignore him. Unlike King Mond and some other tanks, Warrior of Light doesn't have game-winning abilities. Like, he's not going to berserk your entire team, he's not going to reduce your slash resistance and then hit you with a maiming slash. He doesn't have what it takes to win the fight by himself in most scenarios, which means if you just dispel his hate when he's in melee range with your team, he's going to keep hitting you and not generate hate again, and you can just ignore him and go for these squishy characters. Another method, just like for every tank, is to use very large AoE attacks so that it hits both the tank and the carries from the enemy team. So these are methods to ignore him. But if you want to take him out, well, you're going to have to take a look at his build. There are so many different ways to build Warrior of Light that they will not all be weak against magic or all be weak against physical. So you have to take a look at how he's built, since he's so versatile. But generally, since most of his builds are going to depend on defense and spirit, you can just use high defense penetration characters or high spirit penetration characters and have a good performance. Some snipers can get to 100% defense penetration. They're going to deal a lot of damage to him, so there are ways to do that if you want to take him out. And then finally, should you build Warrior of Light? Well, he's a top tier tank, he's very versatile and self-sufficient, so he's definitely going to be strong and top tier for what it is. But he's time limited, and he's coming into a world where King Mond exists. If you ask me, if I could pick just King Mond or Warrior of Light, I would pick King Mond, because King Mond has the same kind of tankiness, maybe not as versatile, not as good versus magic, but what he has in exchange is the ability to win you fights using his very, very powerful kit. While Warrior of Light doesn't have all that, Warrior of Light can stop, King Mond can disable, and then he has all his other AoE stuff on top of that. So should you go for Warrior of Light? I would say if you already have Warrior of Light at 99, and all you have to do is EX him, go for it. It's pretty cheap for a super strong character. But if you don't have him, and you already have some other tanks that you want to use, I would not pull for a time-limited tank and try to max him in this time. It's very expensive to do so, and he doesn't feel necessary to me for those players. So that's my overall verdict. I personally don't have Warrior of Light, so I'm going to skip him and his banner. So that was it, guys. Hopefully you learned a thing or two and enjoyed the video. If you did, please like and subscribe, it really helps out the channel. And then as always, thank you so much for watching and have a great rest of your day.